Jesus the Christ said, I am the good shepherd. We have come to follow him. We gather in the name of the one who leads us by still waters. We have come to be restored in him. We gather in the name of the one who prepares a banquet for us. We have come to be fed by his love. So let us worship God. Welcome once again to Worship with Cornerstone at Westminster. We once again this week are doing a recording from home until things start to settle down from the last session of lockdown and stay-at-home orders. Even though we are now permitted to have small gatherings in a place of worship, we thought it might be wisest to take another week to let things get a little more settled. I'd like to thank those who are helping with this service. Jan will once again be receiving this recording and putting together the final package, editing it. To the Byers family for special music, and to June and Amanda for helping me with another special music, and Amanda for help with the hymns once again. To everyone, please stay safe and continue to pray for one another. Let's begin our worship with prayer. Lord God, our good and loving shepherd, you nourish our lives and lead us into green pastures. You restore our souls with rest and peace. You give us true joy, so our cup overflows with goodness. You walk with us through the darkest valleys, offering us courage and compassion. At all times and in all circumstances, you are with us, Creator, Redeemer, and guiding spirit. So we praise you, Holy One, now and always. Amen. Patient God, your mercy is abundant and your love endless. Trusting in your mercy, we confess that often we have not shown your love to others, even though we claim it for ourselves. You have called us to show compassion, but too often we're quick to judge others. We have been called to follow Jesus, yet we're distracted by our own plans and desires. Forgive us for falling short of your hopes for us and renew a right spirit within us. Amen. The mercy of our God is from everlasting to everlasting. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel in Jesus Christ. God's generous love reaches out to embrace us. We are forgiven and set free to begin again. Let us give thanks for God's most generous love.
Christ rises glorious.
The first scripture reading today comes from the book of Acts. It's another sermon showing how Peter and the apostles would have preached during the early days of the church. The message that they're giving in this particular sermon illustrates how the early Christian tradition grew out of the Jewish tradition, and yet it also shows a part of the conflict between the two. Reading now from Acts chapter 4, verses 5 to 12. The next day, their rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health, by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." And the second passage comes from 1 John. There's some difficulty with this particular passage among scholars. It seems to jump from topic to topic, and also the original Greek can be read in different ways. Rather than trying to explain it, I'd simply like to share it with you. Reading from 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 to 24. "We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him. Whenever our hearts condemn us, for God is greater than our hearts and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit that he has given us." And our gospel reading comes from John. It presents a very familiar theme in scriptures, Jesus as a good shepherd. Unlike the Old Testament readings, that show the Messiah as a shepherd, this passage focuses on the willingness of the shepherd to lay down his life for the sheep. This fits in with the apostolic church's view of Christ as the Messiah. Reading from John chapter 10, verses 11 to 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. And the lectionary for today also included the reading of the 23rd Psalm. Instead of reading this passage, I've asked June and Amanda to help me to present it in music.
Heard I not want.
The idea of Jesus as a shepherd caring for his flock is a very common one in Scripture. We find it in both the Old and the New Testaments. Two of the most familiar passages are our Scripture readings today, from Psalm 23 and from John 10. There is a story, possibly true, if not, it really should be, about a famous actor in the days long before television or even radio, who was visiting a town, entertaining the people with some of his recitations. At the end of his presentation, he asked if there was any particular story that the people would like to hear. One older gentleman asked him to recite the 23rd Psalm. The actor agreed and started his recitation. He used all the skills that he had learned to give a dramatic presentation of the psalm. As he finished, the crowd broke into applause. But the actor then asked the elderly gentleman who had requested the recitation in the first place to come up and give his own version of the psalm. The man began quite humbly, but as he spoke, his face took on a look of peace and joy. You could almost hear the love in his voice. When he finished, you could have heard a pin drop. After a moment's silence, the actor said, "You see, I know the psalm, but he knows the shepherd." I think we can easily understand the analogy of Jesus as a shepherd. I'm sure you've all heard many times the explanations how the people that Jesus was speaking to were mostly rural folks. They were familiar with the agricultural system of the time. Sheep and shepherds were very well known to them. Also, they understood that a shepherd was much more to the sheep than just someone who led them from one pasture to the next. But I think we also have to ask ourselves a very important question as we think of these passages. Are we like the actor in the illustration? Do we know the psalm or do we know the shepherd? I think too often we can become more focused on knowing the verses from Scripture than on knowing the one that these verses are describing. Do we know the shepherd? Sadly, it seems that we live in a world that really doesn't know him. Even people who are familiar with Jesus, people who know of him, often don't truly know him. They may know that he was a great teacher, that the Sermon on the Mount, for instance, is some of the most important teaching of moral obligations and morality that we can find anywhere. They may know that he was a very good man, a man who cared for the sick and the poor. And even though these things are true, they aren't the whole truth. Some people may even study the Scriptures. They may be able to quote verses, even speak passionately about them, but that doesn't mean that they know the shepherd. Knowing the Bible verses that tell of the things that Jesus did during his time here on earth doesn't necessarily help us to know him. One of the difficulties faced by many religious people is that we can become so caught up in the Bible that it almost becomes an idol. I've heard the term bibliolatry used to explain this. The Bible takes on more importance than God himself. The Bible is important. It has its purpose. But that purpose isn't a mere intellectual exercise. Although studying it to understand it is good, it's so much more than that. It's not just something to study and memorize, although memorizing verses from it is good, but it's still more than that. It's not just something that we read to enrich our prayer life, although prayer, time talking to and listening to God, is extremely important. It's not just a tool that we study so that we can argue our point of view with other Christians. Although discussing points of view and learning from those discussions is important. But the Bible is so much more than that. The scriptures are our way of getting to know the shepherd. Our way of coming into a right relationship with him. The Bible is the written word of God, and so it is important. But just imagine this. You're going on a picnic in the park. As you're driving, you see a sign pointing out the direction to the park, and so you stop at the sign. And you take out your lunch, and you set down your blanket, and you enjoy your lunch there by the sign. And afterwards, you may take a picture of the sign, and then you get in your car and drive home. Have you had a picnic in the park? Absolutely not. You found the signpost, and you had your picnic there. In many ways, that's what the Bible really is. It's a signpost that points us to the shepherd. If you find yourself reading the Bible, but you know that you aren't meeting the shepherd there, it's probably time to retrace your steps, to try again. You may have actually missed the sign pointing the right way. The important thing that the Bible should teach us is that Jesus died for our sins, Jesus was resurrected, and Jesus ascended into heaven, and that he now lives there, still alive, and advocating for us and preparing a place for us. When we understand these things, we're well on our way to knowing the shepherd. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus spoke to Peter, "Feed my lambs, feed my sheep, feed my sheep." This was the good shepherd speaking. This was the shepherd that we need to come to know. And if we do know this shepherd, we need to follow that command. Feed my sheep. Feed them by comforting a brother or sister who's in some sort of difficulty. Feed them by raising your family to love and serve the Lord. Feed them by teaching others in your congregation about the Good Shepherd. Feed them by teaching a Sunday school class or a Bible study. Feed them by greeting people as they come into the church and making them feel welcome. And hopefully that's not too far in the future. Feed them by welcoming strangers into the church whenever it is that we are able to return. Feed them by sharing the good news of the gospel with everyone you possibly can. Feed his sheep faithfully as he gives you the grace and the strength and the knowledge and the opportunity to do so now and for the rest of your life. Amen.
I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Blind man that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to wander and stray. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, as a shepherd cares for the flock, so you care for each one of us. Move in our hearts and minds, in our congregations and in our communities, and lead us to care for one another for the sake of Jesus, our good shepherd. Today we thank you for the gift of rest. We pray for all those who are tired from work or worry, especially in these days of pandemic. Grant peace to those who are worn out with anxiety or frustration, and rest for all those who are weary from the responsibilities of their work. God, our guide, we thank you for the gifts of truth and wisdom. We pray for those who cannot discern truth in the midst of conspiracy theories, and for all who suffer under authorities who distort reality for their own ends. Grant wisdom and common sense to all who must make decisions in these confusing days of competing arguments. God, our strength, we thank you for the ways you refresh our souls. We pray for those whose lives are burdened with poverty or with uncertainty about the future beyond this pandemic. We remember all who face any sort of trial or difficulty, those who are sick, in pain, or facing death, and those who are bereaved by the loss of someone dear. For all of these precious souls, be their source of healing and peace. God, our shield and defender, we thank you for staying with us when we face danger or death. We pray for all those who live in fear, prisoners, exiles, and refugees, victims of oppression, racism, hatred, those who know the threat of violence day after day. Be for them a steady companion and their source of courage. God, our provider, we thank you for all the ways that you fill our cup to overflowing. Thank you for offering peace and calm in the midst of turmoil, for the return of happiness after times of trouble, for insight emerging after confusion and indecision. Help us to recognize your redeeming gifts, which guide us and give us hope. Show us how we can be part of your redeeming work unfolding in the world around us. Bless those who serve in challenging missions in Canada and around the world. Equip them to reach out in love and respect, together with local partners, to accomplish your will in Jesus' name. Hear us now as we offer the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Faithful follower I would be.
Righteousness of faith and live by God's just demands. Let nothing claim your devotion above the Lord, and count nothing of value beyond knowing the Christ. Press on towards the ultimate prize of being one with Him. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all today and every day of your life. We go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.